Greetings once again. Wow. 3 hours and 15-minute podcast yesterday. Did not go up. I guess it got too personal. You know, I'm not perfect. I try to sort of balance this between this and, you know, left brain, right brain. You know, this and music. Yeah, it's strange how that happens like that. I really wanted you to have that. And during the pod, I called it the ultimate podcast on what gang stalking is relative to spiritual warfare. And it was the... I guess it really became show prep for this one because it was just heavy. It captured a mood, you know. And maybe we shouldn't try to do that here on podcasts. It's the wee hours. The moon is up a couple days before Thanksgiving. The psychopaths are doing their PSYOP false flag. All terror attacks are false flag, basically. So, yeah, the psychopaths are the guy in the White House, the last guy in the White House, people in the military-industrial complex, people who fly the chemtrails, whatever, you know, the people that did 9/11. They wear business suits. Their kids go to private schools. They're privileged. Oh, and incidentally, they worship Satan structurally, formally, in their groves and in their covens and in their associations. After all, they are a collective of the elite. They look to recruit people that have talent and various ways, but that recruitment is into slavery and the second death. And it can't be restated too many times. I mean, you know, the people that, and your, a lot of your spiritual warfare, gang stalking and things like that. I mean, I read everything there was to read on the internet, and I can just tell you, I'm so sorry for most of you because, you know, you people that are trying to figure it out and reading all the literature amounts to nothing. Yes, they catalog all the things that happen, and every one of those things could be attributed to spiritual warfare. Every single one can be attributed to the same persecution that the true Christians face, whether they be here or, you know, anywhere else. And it's always the same thing. But there seems to be this controlled opposition that are just, these are just double agents who are out there writing their books and doing their thing to explain to you that, you know, and they're getting you to, like, march around with picket signs to stop the government from doing electronic harassment and warfare and things like that. And it's just much bigger than that, you know. But they laugh at you, of course. They laugh at me. They laugh at us when they pulled off the Paris PSYOP, which, you know, the stupidest people in our society are the news media. They're the dumbest of the dumb because they're compartmentalized and stupid. You know, they're the worst kind of stupid. They're the kind of stupid that poses as somebody that knows something when they know nothing of the truth. I mean, they literally, you could say this blanket statement, and it's really true. They really know nothing. And to watch them go on and on about whatever they think is hilarious. I mean, it's just like watching comedy, you know? And it's like watching, it is true comedy. And all you need now are just like a laugh track to go along, you know what I mean? To go along with it. Every time they say something, you need to have laughter coming in. But in my researching of it, and I have to be careful today not to be too personal. I got deep into some stuff on the pod that was you know, it's not meant for you to know what I know in that regard, because there are certain things that I have to hold back because, you know, it just involves my own ability to conduct spiritual warfare because I've been battled on a daily basis. I have never known a let up in the battle. It's just been like that, you know, every once in a while there's a respite, I suppose. But it's quickly followed by, you know, the need to be up at 1 a.m. doing this, you know. Why? Because, you know, the Lord, well, he, you know, I interact. And then, you know, there's a need out there. And you know, and here I am. I've a couple of things. Number one, when we talk about the Matrix holographic world and all that, that's fine to a certain extent, so long as we're not confused. The creation, God speaks into existence, obviously. You know, it's the sound, right? It creates. Okay, and the word is sound, right? The Zephyr Report's all about, you know, the whole musical journey is all about sound, right? Frequency and sound. You know, singing, poetry, spoken word, Zephyr Report. It all falls under the arts, actually, you know, not under what I would say, you know, one is kind of critical and now what I said before, like right brain, left brain, it's all really from the creative side because that's where, if the Lord's going to speak or if there's any inspiration, it comes from there. And, you know, we had warnings, you know, about, and then I thought, well, how silly. What good is it of me going on a podcast and warning them about more terror strikes on U.S. soil, let's say? I mean, that's like, duh, you know, I mean, anybody could think that. I can say this, they turned off the terror attacks. They had a bunch more planned. I don't think you're going to see anything in Belgium. I think that's just conditioning of the public. It's just pathetic. It's Belgium is a joke, a literal joke. The people there are a joke. I told you the Europeans were completely hornswoggled, mind-controlled, brainwashed, and basically done. You know, I mean, Europe is done. That's basically my assessment of the whole thing. It's done. It's like taking candy from a baby at this point. There's no fight left in them, right? You can just walk in and take over the place. And that's exactly what they're doing at the behest of the American, the French, and the European governments. Are bringing the replacements in to replace you. But because they know you're not going to do anything about it. You're not going to fight. You got no fight in your belly. So you're just going to let it happen. The whole refugee crisis is about replacing you. It's not about taking care of poor refugees. The refugee crisis was created by Obama because ISIS is his creation. Obama is ISIS. ISIS is Obama. They're inseparable. They even drop leaflets to tell them to please get out of your vehicles because we're going to bomb them. I mean, it can't be more obvious than that. They give it to you on the news. They tell you exactly what they're going to do. These are psychopaths. It's a psychopathic thing to create an ISIS and then go cut Christians' heads off and blow stuff up and just randomly shoot people and shoot planes down. The people doing it are psychopaths. No, I don't mean ISIS. There are psychopaths in our society that you elect to be president or senator or something. So what do you want me to do? You know, I knew that since I was 15 about false flag, about all that. Yeah. Do you forget? When I was a boy, I had the Kennedy thing right in my face. And I figured that out real fast. And boy, everybody jumped on me. I was sick. I was deluded. Because I felt that this Lee Harvey Oswald guy didn't do it. It was a bigger conspiracy than that. And then I also tied in Martin Luther King and Bobby Kennedy. And then about that time, my parents were ready to write me off as a lost cause. And I said, what, for just looking into it? Well, I guess I hit a nerve there, didn't I? Yeah, the only way we can keep this Disneyland thing going is if we all believe. That's right. Along comes Journey with Don't Stop Believing. Perfect mind control meme. Do they know they're doing it? No, I don't think they're consciously aware of their compartment. But all these entertainers are owned and operated by, you know? It was so funny. I was watching an interview seeing Marilyn Manson talking about Satanism. And everyone seems to always go to him for sit. To me, he's just a stupid clown, you know? And what he sings about, I really can't relate to. So I have no, the only thing I like is the production by Trent Reznor. And I always like Trent Reznor. So, you know, that's cool. Not so much Trent Reznor, the singer. It's Trent Reznor, the movie score producer. Trent Reznor, the instrumentalist and studio producer. That's what I, the synth player. But you can tell on some of Brian Warner's productions that you know, Trent's involved. I can hear it because I've been a fan over the years. Especially if soundtracks like The Social Network and a few others were really inspiring. And then Atticus Ross, his partner, did Book of Eli, which I also thought was excellent. And all that. And no doubt, Marilyn Manson is he's trying to make a comeback now. It's really pathetic. It's you know, someone needs to tell him to take the clown get up off and, you know, just do it. Artists do, just be yourself, you know what I mean? Just quit putting on this vaudeville act, which diminishes the Brian as a musician. But his name is Brian, so I'm going to call him Brian rather than Marilyn. Anyway, so he's wearing this upside down pentagram and he's all, you know, got his whole satanic thing going. And I'm just like, you know, you just want to knock, you know, backhand him across the upside the head and just say, you know, get over it. Get over yourself. You know, I know there was a lot of money in it because the kids are stupid. You know, I mean, it's that American kids are stupid. It's like candy from a baby. Once again, I mean, you manipulate them any way you want them to go. So he was paid to manipulate him into Satanism. I mean, that's basically it. Not as a musician. It's not the music they wanted from him. But anyway, so I have very little, you know, I mean, people argue with me, well, he's got good musicians. I said, yeah, everybody that I knew in L.A. that was a studio musician was a virtuoso. You know, could have been in the L.A. Philharmonic or, you know, in the whatever, you know. They're all on that level, you know, they're all that good. So putting together, a band that plays really well in the studio is really nothing in a place like Los Angeles, okay? It's just like... These virtuosos just grow on trees. You know what I mean? It's like you can interchange them at will and they all do the same thing. They all play perfectly. And yeah, they too are all looking the other way on all this stuff. Otherwise, the studio system is a closed family, you know? It's a closed family, beholden to a certain entity. And, you know, you have to understand some things. So when they go to the caricature comic book, Marilyn Manson, they go, well, what is Satanism? Figuring he's the expert. Yes, Brian, tell us what you think. You're the expert. And so they stupidly go, Satanism. And then he says, to Mr. and Mrs. Stupid, he says, oh, well, it's really worshiping yourself. And then, you know, he was a follower of Crowley and all that stuff. A lot of musicians went that way, you know, absinthe, Satanism, Aleister Crowley, you know, the dark arts. And, you know, they go, well, look, I'm a rock star. You know, it worked. It's not worshiping yourself, first of all. I mean, it is, because, you know, you are a god. You're a star. But it is worshiping Satan. Because it is a collective, and it is a hierarchy, and you have to obey the collective when they recruit you, or you wind up dead. That's one little fact that Mr. Brian the Idiot Warner didn't, you know, or Mr. Dishonest didn't say. Well, you know, I don't. I back in the 90s, I remember I might have listened to a couple of records, but I lost interest because it was overly produced. It was just, it just was like a night. What he strikes me as is a, you know, it's just a set of false teeth. That's all. You know, I mean, well, the real singer, whatever, you know, and it's all just, you know, well, to me, it's just laughable. But I mean, you know, it makes money. So I guess that's the point. That's the point of becoming a Satanist, to make money. And the people that rule over you do false flag terror events. They do 9/11, and those are your bosses. I don't know that I'd want to join a club like that, but that's what they've done. Entertainers are basically beholden to the people that did 9/11. The blood is also on their hands because they're benefiting. They're sucking at that same trough. So I would think that a reasonable person would say, you know, maybe that's not a good way to go. Or maybe, you know what, I'm not going to take that shortcut because, you know what, my kids are just going to have to go to public school. Or I'm going to have to educate them at home. Maybe they're not going to grow up privileged because, you know, if you're hanging out with people that do blow up, you know, World Trade Centers and things like that, if that's the boss at the top of the pyramid, I don't know. You know, maybe I'll think about it again. Because all of Hollywood is beholden to secret societies, military-industrial complex, and the rest of it, which is the pyramid. So it's like, you know, maybe I'll think better of it. If you're a real artist, which, of course, I haven't mentioned any today, you wouldn't go that way because it would kill your art. You would just then become a machine, like you'd become a little robot that spits out, you know, Illuminati-friendly... a mindless entertainment that worships materialism and worships the lie of this world of Disneyland, that reinforces the Disneyland lie. Don't stop believing. And so I kind of grew up with this attitude, you know, that was really, people really thought sucked because what can you do with me with that kind of attitude? You know what I mean? How are you going to, you know, be led to the dark side, if that's the way, you know. Oh, well, yes, it's the dark side, right? The promotion is called Dark Side of the Moon, a 1972 iconic album by some band, I forget who they were. And it was all about promoting the dark side so you can have money. So I guess in my preamble today, I don't know if this pod's going to go up. At this point, I think I probably blew it already. But if you get the pod, it's by maybe God's going to give me a pass or maybe not. Like yesterday, he pulled the plug. I went too deep into my own psychology. I went too far. I was scary. It was really scary. Really scary for the worlders. You know what I mean? And I think the Lord's trying to stop me from just, you know, picking a fight right now because when they get scared, they want to fight. That's very reptilian. That's all they know how to do. They want to fight. And it's like, no, the Lord didn't bring me here to dangle myself in front of them. You know, Jesus did not hang with the Jews, okay, when they wanted to kill him. And he was in the temple. He had to leave. And he didn't say, well, it's my duty to go back and hang out with them and convince them. No. When they wanted to kill him, he would stay away. He confronted her every once in a while, but basically he stayed away. So likewise, I think that's pretty good advice. It is advice. You know, if you're representing God, you know, and the truth, then the people of the lie, the Satanist, which of course isn't just worshiping yourself, it's agreed upon slavery in exchange for goodies. You know, if because you worship yourself, you give yourself that option, but just think of all these terror attacks and everything else and wars and whatnot, blood's on the hands of the Satanist for all that stuff. They say that's okay to accept that level because after all, I'm worth it. Or it's even more bizarre than that. It's like, yes, it is all a deception, but I want to be the one purveying the deception. You know, I want to hurt the public. I want to do bad things to boost myself, especially if I'm covered. Oh boy, yeah, then I can really, And that out of that milieu is where your gang stalking comes from. And I read so much material, so much secular material, I mean, everything, you know, from electronic harassment to, you know, microwaves to this, that. I've been through pretty much the gamut, including, you know, being on the Truman Show, closed circuit TV, you know, friends and neighbors that are all actors. I don't even think that, I mean, I've had the treatment, like really expensive treatment, you know. So I think I've seen it on a level more than what you have. And I don't care what kind of, people that tell me they're TI say, well, when did this start, I would ask. Well, about 4 years ago when I, yes, you have to have done something to tip them off. Well, you don't really need to have, you know, it doesn't need to be something concrete, but they just have to, there had to be a point where they could see you. Oh, who are you? The reason, well, why did you get chosen for this? Oh, that's very simple. Because you're chosen not in time, fool. I'm sorry to insult you all. I roll that back. You're not a fool. The fool is the world and the world system, because it's soaked in blood and evil, you know, and there will be a recompense for that. That's the purpose of this podcast today, to discuss this recompense. Psalm 91. Oh, my goodness. The Lord is opening up a big can of whoop-ass right now. Yep, and I got to tell you about it. But before I tell you what may very well do you all in, I might as well tell you about this gang stalking, because, you know, the thing is it is just another form of spiritual warfare is all, in witchcraft. The people that are chosen, targeted, to put it in the modern vernacular, are those people that are chosen from another dimension, that are known in another dimension to be people that are on the other side and not recruitable. See, if you're not recruited, that's all it takes, is not being recruitable to be targeted. So they know, because they see the future in the past, they know you're not going to be recruited, so you're therefore a threat. And, you know, what they don't recruit, they stalk. It's just as simple as that. If they recruit you, i.e., oh yes, Brian, to be a Satanist, wah, wah, nod, wink, you are beholden to the hierarchy that you've now submitted yourself to in exchange for goodies that the world might leave at your doorstep. Oh, isn't that nice? I earned it. There are also powers, talents, and all that that come with it. You know, you've seen them, right? Have you seen the pictures of the Hollywood celebrities before and after, right? You see the change. Same thing in high school. Remember Zero to Hero? Boom overnight. Remember that? All of a sudden, could barely play three chords, but now is doing leads like Jimmy Page. You know what I mean? Yeah. Oh, yeah. I saw that all over the place. That's everywhere. That's cosmic. Worshipping yourself? Oh, yes, but there's this other thing. Yeah, what's that other thing? Those of you who lied about it, like Brian, the other thing is this big thing that, you know, you're recruited into and you really can't get out. Yeah. Oh, that. Oh, well, I guess I forgot to mention that. I gave the impression that it was all about you worshiping yourself, and that's what a real Satanist is. That's how you attract the really powerful entities who give you the talent to do music and singing and be a star and put the like fairy dust on you so people really like you and love you and worship you. Oh, yes. Well, there's a little price for that kind of privileged treatment, isn't there? And the elites, the people that I guess I grew up with, they have their suits and their ties and their, you know, and they have their world government, and they have their military, and they have their tradition, and their leather chairs, and their clubs, and their, you know, their scotch on the rocks, 25-year, please, minimum. A single malt, if you will. Golf, yes, lots of golf. Oh, they play lots and lots of golf. And they seem like really nice people, you know, until you get in the back room with them, and they're planning out you know, divvying up the world, right? And the people be damned. They laugh at the people, the little people, stupid little people, just move them around, blow them up, whatever, use them for target practice, who cares? And that's literally how they talk. And I've been there when they talk like that. Oh, when I was a little boy, they didn't think I'd remember. All right? That's great, you brought your grandchild here. Divvying up the world. And yeah, you know, there's enemies out there too. So it's not like a cabal where they're all divvying up the world the same. One people are divvying it up, the other one's on the other side of it, so they're going to plan a little war. Convince those people they're going to have to stand down. Same thing with this Putin thing, how they tried to get that going and couldn't fail. They try and fail all the time in the public eye. You can see them. Just like when the public opinion after Paris was a horrible failure. I'm the only one that said that. But, you know, I'm going to tell you what I got in the spirit. It was a horrible failure, the public reaction to it. A better reaction in Belgium where they just go, yes, I do what you tell me to, government. You're good and we're just depending on you, you know, and the government's the one doing it all, right? They're the ones bringing in the terrorists. Otherwise, it couldn't be there. If the French government and the American government did not cooperate on the Paris so-called terror attack, there wouldn't be one. Oh, I'm sorry, and the American news media and the global news media, if they didn't all lie, there wouldn't be an attack. So what does that make them, all of them? Yeah, you bet. And that's the system. So when you sell out into it, you become a traitor of humanity, a purveyor of wars, pain and suffering globally, so that you and your kids can go to your little private school and you can sit there reading your script on, you know, MSNBC or Fox News or whatever, and because the people are so stupid, they'll accept anything as news. Already there's been people on YouTube, you know, have done a fantastic job at simply pulling apart the entire thing from footage they've been able to glean, and you can see from it that it's, you know, there's a guy walking down the street with a gun that had no bullets in it. It was pretending to shoot people. And then people really did die. I mean, there really is blood there and bodies and whatnot. But, you know, they're very good at this hybrid thing where it's a false flag, right? It's a hoax. And then people also, a certain number die. I mean, they do kill people, but sometimes they don't, like at the Umpqua thing, you know? But the people that are involved in, you know, Obama is involved in how many false flags, how many of these Sandy Hook to Umpqua to this to that to the whatever terror attacks to ISIS itself. This is a long line of crimes. Not anybody's going to say a darn thing about it because they're all complicit too. Now I paint the world the way it really is. This is the way the world really is, folks. And you know, when you look at it the way I'm looking at it, it's hard to find hope. I'm just looking at it the way that I looked at it when I was 16, which is just without filter. You know, if it leads to hopelessness, well, so be it. Oh, they're all bad. Someone said, oh, you hate everyone in the music business. They're all bad. I'd say, no, it's just that, you know, you have to sell your soul to get into it. And so therefore, what do you want me to do? Bow down and worship them? You know, most of the talents don't come from them. They didn't earn it. They act like they earned it, but they didn't. Sometimes it does come from them, you know? You know, it's not all, you can't paint it all with one big broad brush exactly, but in a kind of a general trend way, yes, you can. Hey, you know, I just came to this planet and that's what I saw. I saw the inside on that, on Hollywood. So, I mean, I'm talking from experience of being an inside the thing, not speculating from the outside. I don't know even one person that went into that became an entertainer, and that's what they are. You know, but they're paid big bucks because they influence people, and that's what they're there to do, influence the public. That's why they pay them, and that's why they receive huge. Again, like a lot of these people couldn't play three chords and they suddenly become virtuosos. I've seen it. Or they're just nerdy as can be. The next thing you know, they're this glamour puss, you know. And everyone wants them. And that fairy dust gets sprinkled. Oh, everyone wants you. Yeah, I understand. But please don't tell me there wasn't a deal made for that soul or that soul. Please don't tell me that, because I've never seen that exception. Will you show it to me one day? Lord, if there is an exception, I pray in Jesus' name for you to reveal it to me right now so that we do not misspeak. Is there one? Da 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 da. Wow, that's really hopeless. Yeah, and the proviso on that is, yes, when they start waking up or getting restless, they get killed. Oh, sorry. It's not really funny when they get killed, is it? Oh, they all make it look like suicide, you know, when they're 25 or 27 or... Yeah, if it's if the threat levels, if they're going to tell the truth or spill the beans at any point from having already been on the inside and fed at that trough, then you know, they get taken out, baby. Can't be trusted. And those, I always look fondly on those, as you know, I think the Lord smiles on those, you know, because I feel like, you know, I kind of feel they got involved in this thing, they didn't know what it was. Remember Jim Morrison, who advocated selling your soul to get into rock and roll? Remember that guy? And then he had this one song of 5 to 1, 1 in 5. Remember that? They got the guns, but we want the numbers. And he goes, we want the world and we want it now. We got the numbers. Yeah, we're taking over. That's what everybody thinks when they get into it, that they're... that basically it's you know, what the lyric is saying right there is that, you know, basically we're the youth, we're with the devil, you know, our stodgy parents aren't, right? We're the ones who discovered it. We're taking over 5 to 1, meaning, you know, 1 in 5 is, you know, we got the odds 5 to 1 in our favor. If there's maybe one of them, but if there's 5 of us to every one of them. You know, so we're taking over, like it's the first time. So that shows a great deal of, the lyrics show a great deal of ignorance by a young man who should be ignorant at that age. But very ignorant, obviously. Every generation feels that they're the ones who discovered the devil and the shortcut. And they want to tell everyone about it and get everyone in on it so they could take over the world. What's the whole point of the devil? The world. What's the devil? The world. What's the devil? The world. What's the devil? You want the world? What do you got? The devil. You want the world? What do you get? You get the devil. You want the world? What do you got to bow down to? The devil. You want to worship yourself? Who do you bow down to? The devil. You want talent? Devil. You want talent beyond what God gave you? Only one way, baby. Devil. And then once you're in, of course, you pretend that it's all about you. You worship yourself, yes. You're your own boss. No! You are not your own boss, and the thoughts in your head are not even your thoughts. You wanted to be somebody. So this is what you do. But please do not, for even one second, think that you're sovereign. You is bought and you is paid for. And everything coming out of your filthy sewer mouth is a lie. So why should anyone believe you about anything? Answer, they shouldn't. Oh, they do, of course. Look at how they the tongue-wagging politicians sit there mesmerizing the public. Sure, the public's stupid. They'll believe anything. There's a sucker born every minute, and everyone is a sucker. That's the bottom line with that I've seen. Most people are suckers. They want to believe in something that's completely illogical and impossible to believe, which is basically that this system is good and it cares about them, which is, of course, ridiculous. It does not care about them in any way, shape, or form. They want to believe that, so they do believe it, but then eventually they're proven wrong as they get poisoned as they get betrayed, as their bank accounts go down, as they get fired, as there's no safety net, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Tragedies all down the line and all up the line and everywhere you look. And now the ramping up of false flag terror. They're all false flag. Yeah, that thing couldn't have been pulled off with planning and with the government cooperating and, with a plan, with a plan well in advance. And then of course they blame it on the Arabs, they have like a TV show going, right? Where they're in these cells in the ghetto and they're plotting and planning on taking over. And we have to have Belgium on lockdown forever till Monday because there's a really serious threat. If there's a serious threat and they're hooked in, which they all are, all the agencies, it's shut down in 2 seconds. Boom, boom, done. There is no need of an ongoing threat. This is all social conditioning by psychopaths who want to take everything you have, degrade you and kick you into an early grave, laughing all the way to the bank. And that's basically the way the world works. And there is no exception to that. It's so ugly, and it's even worse than what I'm saying, but right there, you're almost to the point of hopelessness, yes? If I told you how it really is, you would just say, well, that's it, I just should open a vein, and maybe that was it. I was so, my talk yesterday became so depressing, perhaps, that, maybe it would have, people would have lost hope. The only hope that you have, I mean, everything is bad. So the only hope that you actually have, well, it's bad in the sense that for all the good things, there's a bad thing waiting to take that out. That's what I mean. In other words, every avenue that you have there, you're still going to die. You still have terror. You still have the banks. You still have taxes. You still, whatever. It's designed for you not to win. To have the illusion of winning when you're young. And then, you have to keep your mouth shut the rest of your life. They sort of blackmail you into going along. And then, you've basically, we have an entire nation here of mentally ill children, who never really grew up. I mean, they grew up and accepted what it is, and then they joined up, and then they became innocent again in the sense that they went into such a level of mental illness and denial and psychosis that they were able to confabulate this world and don't stop believing and look at it as this hopeful, innocent world at, once again. And it reminds me of David Lynch's Mulholland Drive when the innocent character that just wanted to make it in Hollywood and she was going to be an actress and she gets off the plane and she, some relatives give her a ride to her aunt's place where she can be there for a while in Encino, and Encino is kind of in the Hollywood community a little bit. Never mind, I'm not going to go through it. But, and then she was going to be in this little apartment there and go to these auditions, and really she's, that was all mind control. That was not her identity. She was really this very jaded lesbian actress was, I guess, bi, because she was into this girl, and she also had an affair with this director who rejected her, and, she's just on the verge of suicide and hopeless. But you see, in her, like a survival mechanism within her, she created this Betty where everything was just, rainbows and lollipops and legends of Hollywood and the big screen and all the beauty and wonder, and just like that. So, I mean, it's David Lynch showing us, and then, of course, he shows Satan in the form of a cowboy, which is a meme that's been going around, who really runs everything. And you got to sort of agree to get on the buggy with him and let him do the driving. Right, Brian? Yeah, right, Brian? You got to get on the buggy and let the cowboy drive? Right, Brian? You're not driving the buggy, Brian. Okay, you want to do your little Marilyn Manson thing and keep up your little facade? Fine, get on the fucking buggy. I was going to say freaking, so this could go, I'm sorry. We try to curb those expletives so that it can go on WWCR. And I also use expletives once in a while because I know that the Christian pastors and such won't use those. So I make sure that I use them every once in a while, you know, just to keep myself in check. Lest I boast, you know. Lest I have any virtue worth boasting about, I go ahead and let one fly. Yeah, well, you know, beware of wolves in sheep's clothing, and the sheep's clothing always involves someone that just appears not to sin at all. Yeah, oh yeah. And they'll put a knife in your back as fast as you can say, you know, go, given the right circumstances. Yeah, because they're Satan's best right there. So what's a TI to do? You know, we went the secular route, we went to meetings, we did all this stuff, we don't know why I got targeted, it happened a few years ago, and then it's been just excruciating, and they're microwaving me, and they're cooking me, and they're having sex with me, and all that. You know, you've heard of succubi, succubus, all that stuff. You know, and it's all related to electronics as well, and it has a high-tech thing going on, but some of that high technology is beyond this world and in another dimension. I understand that it's hard for you to understand all that, but look, you have to understand this. The only way out you have, first of all, don't become a professional victim and label yourselves. Second of all, go to the light, to the Lord, Jesus. You know, God, Yahweh, the Creator, Jesus. And the reason why is, you know, because it doesn't mean the persecution stuff. It's just persecution, man. You're being persecuted, you don't know why, until you realize you belong to the Lord, and then you go, oh, I see why now. And then you're supposed to rejoice over it rather than keeping on complaining. What did I see more than anything else out there? Suffering and complaining victims who have no hope, calling themselves TIs. Listing all that they moved into the apartment. You know, weird people moved in, making all kinds of noises and different things so they couldn't sleep. They felt that they were, you know, one of them felt that they were putting some kind of tube through the floor or whatever and piping in poison, you know, harassing them, seeing them on the street and suddenly avoiding them. Look, I've had them where they were walking along, and the minute that I appeared, they turned around in unison and walked the other way as fast as they could to get away from me. You know what I mean? I've had that too, to where if I wanted to, I could get paranoid over things like that and go become a recluse and become a shut-in. Because, oh, you can't trust your environment. Gaslighting out in front, messing with your car, the gas cap keeps being missing. You get a new one, you put it back on, and lo and behold, it's missing. The mirrors are funny and changed, and you know someone's kind of messing with your car. You can't trust the car, you can't trust the garage, you can't trust the apartment, you can't trust the electronics. You're not sure if someone's been in there while you were gone, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It's happening also at work. People are saying, you know, making noises and voices about stuff that's going on back at the apartment that you just rented. How could they know that? And it's just all circling in on you and breaking you down, and you're not sleeping, and you're not functioning, and it's getting harder and harder, and pretty soon you're just going to be dead because there's no light and no hope for you. They're just having their way with you. And when you try to find out what's happening, you find out it's got to be the government. It's got to be the military-industrial complex. They're pulling all this off. Or it's petty criminals. You're not sure which. Or it's law enforcement, but you're not sure which. All you know is you can't trust anything or anyone or your environment, and you're becoming a shut-in, and your behavior is being shaped, and your life is being ruined, and you didn't do anything to anyone. You meant no one any harm. I know you didn't. I know you didn't. They just mean harm to you. And they do it in a very sneaky way so that you grow paranoid. And, you know, they know what they're doing as they're breaking you down. They're breaking you down. They're either going to recruit you or they're going to see you dead. Make no mistake, the sense of death. And people say, well, you know, I'm not dead. Well, no, you will be. You have broken down enough, eventually you will be if you're not recruited. Now, if you're recruited into Satanism, oh, I'm sorry, I mean into gang stalking, then, you know, the boss may have you go up against family members with the proviso that if you don't do what you're told, your children might suffer. So you do. You make those choices. You know, you go over to you see Zeph. Hey, how you doing? And, you know, you pretend to be Zeph's friend. And he'll never know he's on the Truman Show. So you just, you know, and you know, I want you to report back what's happening. And introduce drugs or whatever his weakness is, you know, have it. And then report back to me. And if you don't do it, your kids might not enjoy that nice private school much longer. They'll have to be in the rabble in the public schools. Or whatever. I mean, that's kind of like, you know, the way it works. That's, if you want to call that gang stalking, go ahead. I've had that sort of thing my whole life. When did you start? Five. When I fought back against the pedophiles, it started then. As far as I know, I don't trust anyone. You know what I mean? It's basically whoever talks to me, I kind of talk to them for a while. But I always know that, you know, like I've talked to one person that was, they were being stalked and they were a real TI and they were, had found the podcast and they were all kind of like, you know, very giving lots of flatteries about it, which whenever people give flatteries, you know, eventually they're going to, like Frankie and I would always say, they would eventually manifest. They, you know, right? It was just like, when will they manifest? We're almost taking bets on that. Like, when are they going to manifest? Don't worry, they will. And sure enough, they did, right on cue. And good thing I didn't trust them. Because they're being used, right? They're weak. You know, never trust anyone that paints themselves as a professional victim. Right? We're human beings, not labels of things. You know, and if you've labeled yourself and that's how you identify yourself, don't trust yourself then. You know, you're not a label. You're a human being. Have some dignity. You know, you're fearfully and wonderfully made by God. You know, get into the Bible. Find out who you are. But don't, please don't. I mean, I go on like Godlike Productions and there's a guy going, every night they cook my legs. You know, I mean, it's like, yes, every day they do something. I get, you know, I've mentioned before where I've gotten beamed, you know what I mean? And then I'm just down for 3 days. And it's just part of the, you know, but I rejoice because it's all part of this this great thing of being with the Lord, you know. And, you know, he just doesn't allow us a free pass, you know. But here's kind of the benefits of God. First of all, I have the light. I'm living in the light, and I am a light. I'm a light unto the world. So when I want to look for hope, where I look, hey, Brian, check this out. I look to myself in Christ. I look to myself in Christ, in the light. But in Christ is a cosmic thing. Not exactly the metaphor that floats around here in the Western civilization. It's a little bit different than that. Same concept, but I mean, you know, it's there's a lot of people that claim Jesus who are, you know, fake as all get out. I just saw when I was watching YouTube, and a guy was explaining how the earth was going through the scriptures, how it's a, you know, how the earth was made by God and how everything is as a fixed point in space and everything revolves around it. And it had certain people on, certain experts and, you know, commentators. And I've known these are big time Christian stars. As one talk show gal, Airhead, said, oh, these are mighty men of God. And I just like, I start cracking up. I'm like, yes, but they gang stalk. I guess we should call this Christian gang stalkers. I have been, I've been under the stalking of Christian gang stalkers. Stalked on the internet, stalked, you know, to here in New Mexico, actually stalked. I'd say the main bulk of people I met in Christianity and, you know, the church system and whatnot, they were all gang stalkers. Yes, they were. They'd say things, they'd have trigger words, they'd make noises, they'd go into your house, they move things around. Oh, yeah. You come to the pastor, then he goes, "Tell me all about your problems." This is what gang stalkers do. This is classic. You're getting beat up all over the place. Weird stuff is happening. You're being sabotaged and messed with. They know all that because they're running it. And then you go to them for help. And they knew you were going to come to them for help, right? That was the plan. And then they try to give you advice to help you. You're going to have to get with the group or, you know, you could get picked off, Zev. Get with the group. That's your advice. Join the group, i.e. recruiting. Hello? Light go off, anybody? Light, 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 light. Get it! The people that you're going to tell your problems to are the ones running the game. And it's the whole world is a gang stalker. The entire world. Oh, my God. The world. Jesus won't pray for the world. You know that. John 17. He's not going to pray for the people. No way. Because the world is Satan. The world is the gang stalker. All the supernatural coinkydinks that happen are supernatural coinkydinks, not necessarily planned by someone behind closed doors somewhere plotting against you. It coalesces in interdimensional space. In fact, sometimes the people that are coming at you aren't the people you're going to see 15 minutes later who suddenly seem to have forgotten the whole thing and they just like stepped out of character. No, you just saw a dimensional shift. You went through it. Well, see, I don't worry about it. You know, and then, oh, gosh. All these people are trying to take surveillance and video and, you know, trying to show how these people are, they're coming up and they're sitting there and they're parked there and then they are and then they aren't. Then they are and then they aren't. Isn't that right? It's sort of there, and then it's there, and then it isn't there, and then it's there again. Isn't that the nature of it? That is the way the interdimensional world of gang stalking works. It's there, then it's not there, then it's there again. Just like UFOs coming in and out. Using the very same people that are your family members, significant others, coworkers at work. Yes, they're all used. They're all part of it. And then they're not. And then they are. And then they're not. Meanwhile, you feel terrible. And I don't blame you. Of course, if this thing just gets laid on you and you don't know what's going on, you know, you've discovered all this recently, you know, within the last few years or 10 years or whatever. It's not of this world what's coming at you. It's because you belong to God and maybe you haven't woken up yet or gone to the source, you know, gone to your father, gone to where you belong. So you're just like out there and you're just a free kill, you know? So yes, if they see you walking around out there, they're going to jump on you. If they didn't jump on you earlier, it's because they didn't, you know, you didn't get on their radar till later on. You say, how do I get on their radar? Sometimes you pop on the radar just at random without doing anything or saying anything. I don't remember anything I did or said. And they just started in on me. Exactly. It's just like the government finally finds out that you didn't pay that parking ticket. And then, you know, 5 years later, you get a notice that, you know, you're either going to pay up or be arrested, right? It's like 5 years later. You go, I don't know what I did. I didn't do anything. This thing came in the mail. I don't even remember any ticket. This is harassment. Exactly. That's the way it works. It's like a big bureaucracy. So when the day you're chosen, you feel, or targeted, is not the day that it was decided. It's just, you know, it's there to make you think, what did I do? I didn't do anything. You know, I don't understand. And that's what they want. You to be confused, you do not understand, you do not understand what it is. You will never get an audio or any transmission. This may be, you may get mad at me here, you know, and that's okay. I'm having to take on a particular style of speaking right now to make sure the points all get across, you know, so that you don't just turn this off and go on to the next YouTube or the next thing, because, you know, you have to understand all these YouTubes are worthless. I understand they're trying to do good, but I looked at everything, books, people's testimonies, long written things about all the different things that can happen, the apartment, the house, the job, the marketplace, the doctor, the doctor exams, the shrink, the law enforcement, and on and on and on and on, listing every little thing. Most of which finally becomes the theater of the absurd, because they're listing things that happen to everybody, And then this happened, and then I got this weird thing that showed up in the mail, and I knew, But yes, what I described to you the other day, when we had this music, that the Sweetwater thing that was like anachronistic, and it was just not really, it was just so bizarre how it happened to be the exact. That's another part of the spiritual warfare. They come in and they try to, remember I described to you that I went to this beach club in Los Angeles to meet with a producer about a script that I was writing with this producer guy. And then he had an actor in mind, and we met this actor at a beach club. And there was a certain sandwich that I used to order every time when I was a kid. When I was a kid, I was a member of that beach club, but then I eventually got kicked out because of, as you can imagine. But then this is like many years later, going back with amnesia, as a guest, not as a member, to meet, be on another unrelated matter to my being there. But obviously someone knew I was there, because this guy ordered the exact sandwich I would order, and I don't even think it was on the menu anymore. Okay. I think they called it I'm not going to go into it in case there are people listening. I'm trying not to be too personal here, but I mean, it was the same thing as that experience at Sweetwater, and it happens a million times. I'm just naming one more incident where this actor, I'm sitting in there, they're these cabanas, I'm sitting in the cabana with the producer and with this actor. So he orders that sandwich, and I'm like, automatically I'm triggered, man, and suddenly I'm having a meltdown when he said the name of that sandwich. Because it was like, I was that's all I would ever have, and it was like very, very well known, but it couldn't be. I just said it couldn't be. And then I don't even think it's on the menu. I mean, how could that happen? It's not on the menu, 30 years later. 20 years later, the guy, the chef that made it famous, he's gone. This guy married into the family that had a membership there, so he's a Johnny come lately. He hasn't been there when we were kids, the actor, that is, who was sponsoring us being there, going over the script with him, which turned out to be about something else. So he ordered that. The guy came down to get our orders, and he was giving us lunch, so I'll have a cheeseburger, I'll have a chef salad, and I'll have a so-and-so. What? And it's supposed to trigger all this memory, trying to access me, right? It's on a very deep level, this thing, this event that occurred, very, very heavy. I wanted to get out of there. I had to leave, But then I went into trauma mode. I became traumatized right there in the meeting. And then, which was the intent, obviously, to traumatize me, which it did. And then I could be dealt with, you see. I could be handled. Just like that. I'm not sure if I've really communicated this properly to you. It doesn't matter. Look, the guy said there's no way he knew that. So he said the impossible thing. And yep, it worked. I got traumatized. Right there, I got triggered. Boom. And then I guess they figured, we're breaking him down. That was a good tip telling me to say that sandwich. That really worked. They're experts at it. They know what they're doing. Well, you know, it was some 20 years later, there was, you know, the management had changed. I'm sure that, you know, menus have changed, and, you know, there could, maybe that was on the menu. I don't think it was, though. I mean, I didn't see it. I was looking at the menu. I didn't see it. So the question was, if he wasn't there back then, you know, was he coached to say that? Why am I remembering it right now? It's many years later. This is in 1992, 1993. You know, here we are, you know, much later, you know, let's see, 2003, 2000, 22 years later. Here I am 22 years later remembering that one incident. How can that be? As a trauma? What were they trying to accomplish? Well, it triggered also a fight or flight, you know, like I just had to get out of there. I mean, but at the same time, I was just, you know, I don't know what happened to me there, but it didn't seem that there was any progress on the script. I don't think they really cared about it. I mean, eventually what happened is I got thrown under the bus and they went off and did the movie without me, which was sort of a violation of copyright, but I never pushed it. You know what I mean? If the guy's going to be that kind of an asshole, just deal with it, you know, let him. Movie was a, you know, embarrassing failure anyway. So I'm glad I had nothing to do with it, but they did do that too. I call that the Hollywood shuffle. You know, they couldn't get their way with me. They said the word, triggered, traumatized, but it didn't hit pay dirt. So, you know, under the bus I went. So that was also traumatizing and meant to break me down. So I went to the screening of the guy's film. He never told me, you know, and then I went to the screening. That's a good congratulations. You know, I worked really hard on that, but, you know, I guess you didn't see fit to tell me that you were going to just throw me under the bus and go do it anyway without me. That's really a no-no in Hollywood. I mean, yeah, I could have sued him, but, you know, I just was like, this is just so, I'm out of here. You know what I mean? And that really marked, you know, it's weird because I feel like they got tagged, because that was the end of this guy's career, of this actor. He'd been a TV actor, so he had, you know, royalties from that. But, I mean, he never acted again, as far as I could tell. That was like the death knell. It's almost like he got tagged and put out of business. So when they thought they were betraying me, God was dealing with them. Karma comes back on you, you know. Washed up has been. Yep. Yeah, I've had some experiences. Well, I mean, you need to know some of these because this is not an experience you're going to have. But still, the fact that I can remember it and I can bring it to bear in this thing, it's going to give you a degree of comfort knowing that, hey, you know, that happens to me too. Maybe not with famous actors and stuff, but I mean, you know, not at a beach club in L.A., but I mean, you know, same thing, same structure. Yes. Yes, that's right. Well, I wasn't really welcome there. I was, you know, I was brought in to this, you know, it was so weird they wanted to have a meeting there where I had my youth, you know, where things went wrong, very wrong. Just bringing me back there was already a triggering. Remembering our families, and I think that was the whole point, for I would remember our families, and I knew this family and our family was all friends, and all the kids, we all played together down there at the beach, and, you know, and things just went wrong, you know, trying to bring me back before they went wrong, trying to maybe reason with me, and can't reason with me, then you just throw me under the bus and go do the project without me, without telling me, even though, you know, I'm the one that basically wrote it. Yeah, just don't even tell him. Well, that's a kind of a snake in there. Oh, and this guy was a big-time Christian, the producer, yeah. Big-time Christian. Yep, believed in the Bible. He carried that Bible everywhere with him. And was the, you know, biggest scumbag, or one of them. Anyway, no, I got it. I saw enough, you know. I mean, it was like, it was so bizarre. But I mean, then the triggering it, then you know, at the gas station, you know, there's someone saying something that, how could they know that? You know what I mean? And then, and all around town or everywhere, you know, there's stuff like that going on. I mean, there's millions of incidents like that. I'm bringing up two because it was very, very, you know, because they triggered me, because I got a, because it worked. Now, were there people that tipped it off, or how did that exactly happen? You know, I don't know. It's impossible in a way, but it's coming from another dimension. That's all I can say. And it seems like it's all targeting me. And yes, it is. Yes, it is. But it's not of this world completely. And all the literature I saw on gang stalking and mobbing and bullying and electronics and everything. Nobody seemed to understand, you know, there were like handlers and controllers purveying the information and making sure that nobody went off on any other theory other than trying to get the perps, they kept saying, the perps. Where? They never seemed to get to the perps, you know, they think they know where they are, but they never quite, it never quite gets exposed, the perps. Then they had a little interview with a guy that had been, you know, leader of the pack and recruiting people and going after the gang stalking and, you know, saying that, you know, we really, it comes from law enforcement totally. And basically, we target criminals and we try to ruin their life and screw them up and then hopefully they will confess and then we, you know what I mean? And then lesser people, we target lesser, you know? And it was just like, there's no way that that was anywhere near reality. That little story, interview with a gang stalker, that was, you know, because there's a need for people to have something like that they can put their finger on and say, well, that's there, you see? See? But, of course, it was, you know, part of the controlled opposition. You know, if you really want to succeed in, first of all, you're not going to get free of suffering on this earth. Even if you join the dark side, you're still going to suffer. But if you suffer for Christ, you know, there's no vanity in that. You know what I mean? It all counts for good. The Lord uses that. And the other thing is the Lord protects his own. I got to tell you, a lot of these traps that were set, you know, where they're trying to break me down so they can reach me. So they can, what do you mean reach you? So they can move me to the dark side. That's what they want to do, right? They want to recruit. And then when you get older, they just want you to commit suicide. Yep. Reach me. Commit suicide or recruit. That's specifically what I mean, just in case you don't get it. When you're younger, it's recruitment. When you're older, it's off the cliff. And the Lord sees that. Okay. And then, you know, in my case, he would just, you know, like Frank Whalen observed, you know, he goes, God uses you as bait, Seth. And I'm like, yeah. And other people said it too. I had lunch with this couple and the husband, he's passed away now. He said, you know, you just put a big sign on your back and then walk around and, you know, a big target on your back and you're walking around and they start doing stuff. And it's like, yeah, but how can they see me if I'm not talking to them? And then he was silent, cowed into silence. Yes. Collective. They see you. How do they know? Because the little bird tells them. You know, there's a little, they just know because there's somebody else looking through those eyes, not them, and they know you. Yeah, sure they know me. So when that happens, it doesn't really freak me out anymore because I'm used to it. Usually that's called spiritual warfare, when a demonic entity comes through a person and you think they took their mask off, but it's really a demonic entity, and they're coming at you, and they know you, and they're looking at you like, oh, what a loser, and they're going to say something that only you would know. Well, because the demonic realm are the ones who do know that stuff, not the terrestrial realm. But they attribute it to these people just sharing knowledge who are in the gang stalking movement. And it's not a movement. It's called the world. It's the world. You're just not in on it. Jesus will not pray for the world, because that's what it is. They come from below, we come from above. That's correct. We're not really even the same species. That's another issue that never gets talked about. And yes, lambs, those that belong to God, you know, the meek, our meek here, you know, don't have special superpowers, no, are targeted and followed all their lives. All my life, even before five, I always had, you know, them, all the watchers, they were always watching me. Absolutely, everyone, they were all watching. Watching, watching, watching. So I just figure, well, I'm being watched. Might as well give them a show. And at times they'd throw, oh, yes, it was run by witchcraft. I'm sorry. The high technology is the witchcraft. And they run that, and they throw things at you, and they do spells on you, and they get little pieces of clothing and different things and make voodoo dolls out of it and stick pins in it. And they do all kinds of things like that. All part of the targeting. At one point, this gal down in Melbourne, Australia, she put me in a pyramid cage, an effigy of me. You know, she's a witch. And, you know, I interacted with her on a music site one time, and she figured I was a lamb or whatever. Next thing you know, I'm in a pyramid cage, and she's controlling me. And when you're in the pyramid cage, in the center of like a pentagram, how do I know this? Because I could see it. Because I have a gift. Wow, good thing I have that gift, because if I didn't have that gift, I might be hamburger by now. And already consumed and pooped out somewhere. Back to the elements. Yeah. Yeah, I could see it. And oh, how did I know? Because when I confronted her about it by writing a song called The Pyramid Cage, she disappeared and never reappeared again. She went running and screaming out. I tend to have that effect on witches. There was another one who did some sort of song, you know, some kind of a deal about, I don't know, it didn't look too bad to me, you know, I mean, I didn't really have eyes to see whether that was a ritual, and I didn't know whether it was some kind of ritual or not. There was these girls, like, you know, demanding this guy, you know, take his pants off and whack off in front of him or something. To me, it seemed like porn, you know. But then there was another element to it. So but they never really got to the point of the porn. They kind of were, you know, kind of moving in on this guy, you know, in a witchy fashion. And so I asked, I said, well, what's going on here, you know, to her? I wasn't quite sure what I was hearing. And she did a video, so I wasn't quite sure what I was seeing. You know what I mean? It had that vibe on it, though. Not like porno, like you would see, you know, where there's like a bondage thing and they pull the guy's pants off and they, you know, make fun of his little penis, or they worship his giant penis or whatever it is. I mean, that's porno. It's really devoid of that sort of thing. No, this had that sort of thing going, you know, it wasn't really what it was. So I asked her what it was, and she went screaming and running away, and she never came, but she says, I'm so sorry, and she immediately took it down after having all these positive comments. All the guys were saying, count me in, I'm with you, you know, like they knew what was going on. So that's what kind of tipped me off, that it was something else. And I guess they were all just kind of tripping over themselves to take part in this ritual. I guess it would be sex magic. And I just asked what it was. That's all I did. And oh, I'm so sorry. I am so sorry. Please forgive me. And took it down like a posting. You know, I think it was a video, but it already had everybody in the community who chimed in on how great it was and how great the music. She was a great musician, and she was in the film industry. Took it down, and then disappeared, after being really popular, having lots, like being number one a lot, and having everybody chiming in on her post. You know, just having them eating out of her hand. Now, a good place, it was her home, in a way. And abandoned her home, abandoned everything, and ran. What do you think scared her so much? Oh. I'm being a bit facetious with that question, as you can tell. Yes. Indeed, but she was tagged, of course. I'm not going to follow up on it. But that's what she was afraid of. She was afraid of somebody, some kind of thing, because she's not supposed to be. She thought she was on a closed site where there wasn't anybody that would ask a question like that, you know, because they're not supposed to really talk out of turn. Something really scared her, though, like she was going to be killed. Like that kind of level, you know, get rid of the, run. I didn't do that. Sorry. Wow. So jumpy. Something's not being said here. Something is not being, I'm so sorry. What, I don't, you know, I'm not offended if you're doing like a soft porn thing and it's not really getting to the skin part. It's just kind of this, but that's not what it was it? No. Not even close. The other thing was, you know, you could tell that it triggered all the men who were slaves, you know, because they were like, yes, Jezebel, my testicles belong to you, or whatever, you know. It was just so weird. I'll never forget it. It was just like that pyramid cage thing, you know. So I wrote a song. Who had me write the song? Well, I didn't do a very good job with it, but it got the point across. Who had me write it? The Lord. Who gave me the vision of the pyramid cage and the pentagram? The Lord. Who confirmed it? The music confirmed it when she ran away. The pyramid cage. And she ran and ran and ran. And that's how I confirmed that that was actually literally real. No, I saw the Lord showed it to me. I mean, it was in her home, in the living room, in the circle. And it was like a bamboo type of thing, you know? You could see through the pyramid cage, like, you know, it's a cage with a little doll in the middle. Well, that was me. So they were targeting me, you know, and they'd every once in a while take me aside. Hey, dude, you have to use so many cuss words. They would take me aside of the Truman Show there on that site and talk to me like, you did this one song called One. I did, it was called One. I produced hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of songs in the past. They've all kind of, I don't know where they've gone, you know, maybe some people collected them, I don't know. You know, for me, it's just, I don't know what happens. It was called One, and I was taken aside to go, oh, they really like that, Zeph. Ah, because I was talking about one consciousness, one people, you know, one vibe, one. And then they say, see, look, that one was popular, Zeph, as opposed to the other things I'd be writing. Trying to hint, hint, nod, nudge, nudge. Hint, hint, nudge, nudge. See, this is the kind of thing, Zeph. I mean, this one cat, he wrote a song for me, or about me. I had only been there 5 minutes, and he already had my number. And he goes, you know, the song was called The Cost of Being Different. The Cost. He was already adding up the cost. I'd only been there 5 minutes. This one's for you, Zeph. Oh. Shoot, so there's no way I can. And they would always hold me down. I mean, they'd always make sure that I got so many plays, but not enough to ever be in the top 10 for any week. And I know that was, they were fixing the number. They were fixing my account. They were making sure that I never succeeded there, you know, that I was always going to be a second-class citizen unless I played ball and became a pagan. One consciousness, one people, one vibe, one hive, one slave. But if we're all slaves, then the illusion is Disneyland and we're all free. You see, as long as we all play ball, we can all be free. But if anyone is throwing a wrench in it, then we're all miserable. You see how that works. So there was a aura of vengeance always against me. There was a, you know, they put up with me and then they'd turn on me, but it was always like being, you know, the basement bastard, right? Never accepted. And then the guy took me aside. He says, look, you could, you know, overcome all this by going down this path of one. When you did one, you know, that's the way. And, you know, welcome, you know, let's do that, Seth. And then, you know, maybe you can get in the top 10 once in a while, you know? So I was coached. I was told that, you know, the way things are going, it's not gonna work out good, you know. Then eventually, this guy who was being really nice to me, because I would show up and I'd be there a couple. Then I, you know, when they started, I'd leave. You know, I'd leave, then show up again. And eventually, he got really mad at that I would just leave like that and then come back. When things got heavy, I just leave and then I'd just show up again and put another song up there. I eventually got to the point where I just put a song up there, and I would just stay gone. You know, I wouldn't even look to see if anyone listened or not. You know, and then this guy disappeared. He might have died. You know, they do die. You know, he's of old age probably. You know, but yeah, there's another generation there now. It's, you know, all gone. But it was just another thing where you know, I'm like, how can you? If I'm on the internet, you know, talking through a forum, a music forum, how can you see me? You know, if I'm being pleasant and nice, and are we just there for the music? And the answer is no. No, that it goes on everywhere. It's really interdimensional. It's got nothing to do with the actual physical world or physical realm. They just know. And you know that they know that you know that they know. So we all know. So we're all in kind of a Mexican standoff, aren't we? Right? And so the same warfare goes on there. Now, I could say that's all coinky-dink and stalking and look what they're doing, but I had to go deeper than that because, I mean, we were having pyramid cages now and it's starting to get serious and people are running off, prominent people, you know, prominent people from like the film industry and other places that were there, running away like scared little girls, you know. So if people getting pissed and then I disappear for a while and come back, eventually they just kind of flip me off. Then I'd be nice to them again. It just never really, you know what I mean? It was just like this dance of, you know, of repulsion that we could never be together. It was just like two magnets repulsing one another. And so I said, how do I get over there where you are? It seems impossible. And then it's like, well, we're never going to be over there where you are, Zeph. You know, we got lots of Christians over here. So that's not what the repulsion's about, you being a Christian. Oh. Now that answers a lot. A lot. Well, it's just nothing but pain and suffering for yours truly. This is all very painful for me because I, you know, like you out there, all I wanted was some friends and some fellowship. I didn't mean anything, any harm to anyone. But they intended harm to me. They intended to break me down and to shame me, to humiliate me and break me. And they could care less whether I put a bullet in my head or join them. Either way, they win, I figure. And that's just the way the mean machine works. And all these people were participating in it. I mean, they had, like, I'd comment on that. So I, you know, would play a game. Like, I would comment, oh, that's such a great song, and butter them up so nicely and all that stuff, right? And then they just hated that. Anyway, they were just hanging around waiting to see what I would do. So I kept disappearing until finally I just became so obscure that they forgot about me. Well, it never was going to be any good. They were never going to let me into the top 10. Every once in a while, they would rotate the top 10. And, you know, you get there, if you've been there long enough, you know, everyone gets in the top 10. And, you know, it's kind of a rotation thing. Unless you're like me, then, and I had some great songs back then. I mean, really good song. And also commented on everybody's thing. So I was due. but they would never let me in that sacred top 10. That was reserved for them only. Oh, they're them, and we're an us. Never the twain shall meet, never will there be collusion, never will there be... You can try to make them like you, like I did. I buttered them up. I did everything I could to make them like me. I just wanted to be liked. This broken soul, this broken person, me, wanting to be liked. So pathetic. You know, and I just couldn't understand, well, what was the conspiracy against me about? What did I do wrong? And I keep going back of, this time I'm really going to try to be nice. I'm really going to be nice this time. And they just wouldn't, they just kept on like that, like you're sub from another planet, or you're the, you know, they just kept on. You know, it's a form of bullying, actually. And, you know, and making you, you know, triggering you, making you feel like some sort of pariah when you're not, when you know you're not. And making sure that, you know, you're not in the connected. You know, you're not, you try to get connected, but they're going to make sure that you know that you're not connected. No matter how nice you are, no matter how much you help, no matter how you help in collaboration, no matter what, there's going to be this wall. And it's just going to be the most awful thing. That was the most awful experience I've had online. It was just terribly painful for me because I tried everything I could for acceptance, anything. But the only thing that would have worked, and you know, funny, I met people there that said, well, the reason that I'm not in the music industry, you know, when people are really good, they go, because I didn't want to sell my soul. So I just thought that was, oh, you didn't sell your soul? Well, then maybe you and I are kindred spirits. Nope, we're not. No, we're not kindred spirits. I didn't want to go in the music business because I didn't want to sell my soul, because it's well known, that's just the, you know, standard operating, that's just the norm. Nothing exotic being said here in the Zeph report. So she wouldn't sell her soul, eh? Well, that makes us, maybe we're like more like bros and sisters then, right? Not on your life, buddy. Nope, not you. Yeah, but I thought you just said you weren't going to sell your soul to get into Hollywood or whatever, and so you're just doing music for yourself because you didn't want to sell your soul. So doesn't that... Nope. No connection whatsoever with you. Wow. Boy, that's a kick in the teeth. Thank you very much. Wow. Well, that's painful, man. That hurts. That's really awful. That's what, would you tell me what it's all about? No way. Back of the bus. You're lucky you're even on this bus. I know, I'm so low. I mean, I'm an eighth class citizen. That's right. And you better start, acting like it and even be nicer than you've been. And maybe we'll put up with you. That's really harsh. Well, what can I do to make it better?
I don't know. What can you do?
Oh, it's like that, huh? Yeah. Jeez, wow. So you're going to just hold me in my position. So what, you can throw rocks at me, insult me, just get off on treating somebody in a hostile, mean manner? Is that what you're all about? Is that how you roll? Yep, that's how we roll. You can't figure it out, that's your problem. Until then, we're going to throw rocks at you. That's right. No matter how nice you are, we're going to make sure you're miserable, okay? Oh, thank you for your nice comments, Zeph. Now go F yourself. Wow. Or you give me nice comments and I'm just not even going to show up and give you anything. Okay, you really hate me. Yes, it's more like vengeance rather than hatred. Vengeance, like I've really done something to you. Yes, you have. You just can't see it. Now, let me explain what that's all about. The vengeance is Satan to God. You, Zeph, meaning all of you, are simply caught up, you know, in this drama on a particular side of things that is not socially acceptable. They expect you to figure it out and get out of your dilemma, and they can't help you do that because they're not allowed to, or they get in trouble because they're slaves. For you to be accepted by them, you too must become a slave and break on through to the other side of something that doesn't exist and never did exist. So you got to figure that one out. If you can't figure it out, they're going to keep on after you until they break you in a million pieces. And even if you ask them for help and you do everything they say, you still won't break on through the other side, because there's not, it's not up to you. I mean, it is, but it isn't, if you know what I mean. You go to where you belong. And if God doesn't want you there, because it is a God thing, then no matter what you do, I don't care how much you sin, you could jump into every one of their rituals they have, you still won't be one of them. The rituals are very subtle with them. You know, like I showed you, they were doing one with some gal's video, and then I asked her about it, she ran away. But I mean, and then they took vengeance on me for that. You know what I'm saying? I had to get out of there. Fortunately, that just means don't log in, rather than, you know, being stuck physically. Okay, so basically you're in the position of, they're not going to tell you what the stalking is or where it comes from or why you were targeted. You have to figure that out for yourself. And if you can't figure it out, they're just going to keep after you till they break you in a million pieces. And that's just the sad reality of it. When you see them behave that way, then you're damn sure you don't want to join them. Why would you? To become a monster like that. And when they're nice to you, they're just pretending to be nice to you. They're just waiting till they can get you alone somewhere so they can mess with you some more. Or they can get away with it. And this was happening on a music site. On a forum in cyberspace. Same pain. Same thing, different venue. Repeated throughout wherever you are, all over the world. So you become a shut-in, because when you go out, this kind of thing happens again and again. You know, someone just looks at you with seething anger and vengeance, someone you don't know, looking like they just want to kill you. And after a while, you just can't take it anymore. What the heck did you do to that guy? And the answer is nothing. He was taken. You're being targeted, all right, but not by this man with the evil look in his eyes. He was taken over to do that to you because they saw you a coming. You understand? They get out in front of you. So you're going to go to the market. You're going to go to the doctor. You're going to go to the vet. You're going to go. They can get out in front of you, and they're there waiting for you. They're there before you. Because the people that are there get taken over, because most people belong to that reality. You don't. And that is why you're targeted. I could go over this again and again, if you like. You will never have a more thorough and more understandable explanation as to your targeting ever from anyone in the world. I may be the ultimate expert in this. Maybe this is my gift. I don't know. But I do know that when I was your age and when I was younger, when I was 18, I needed to hear this podcast because, see, it would have given me a lot of comfort. I would have understood a little better. And I would have known that I better pick where I got to go. I know I got to go to the Lord, because I got to go to my Creator. I've got to go to my Maker, because that's the only relief I'm going to get. And then he'll tell me more about this whole thing. Now, I've described a few incidents just to kind of help you out, but I mean, you know, they're you know, numerous. I mean, you know, being on candid camera, you know, coming in and messing things around and having, you know, no privacy anywhere. They're your neighbors. They're driving up down the street. There are people parked over there, sitting in their car, looking at you, waiting for you to leave the house. Then are they following you? You know, until it finally gets unbearable. And then usually, a lot of times, people kill themselves. That's right. That's a big. And then, you know, when I go online, that's not mentioned very much, the suicides. I'm like, my God, man, suicide is the name of the game here. This happens millions of times, suicides. How come it's not mentioned here? And now you're starting to understand, aren't you? They don't want to mention that part. And in most cases, they're not trying to recruit you. They're just going to mess with you. They don't care what you do with, you know, Satan, them, this, that, the other thing. They're just on it. What you've got to do is you've got to figure out why. And when you do, there's only one decision that you will make. And I know exactly what that is. You will decide to go to the source of all creation and ask for help. That's what I did. That's what we all do. And that's the only help you're going to get. The only, let me underscore that twice. The only help you're ever going to get. The humans are not going to be nice to you. They're already spoken for. They're owned and operated by the head gang stalker. Mm-hmm. They've been recruited. They made the choice because they wanted to live. And they felt that if they didn't join up, they wouldn't live. So they joined up. Because many of their friends committed suicide already, so they didn't want to go that way. So that's why they made their decision. That's why I don't blame them for making that decision. I'm not mad at them, personally. But, you know, understand from my point of view, I would not want to be a part of something where people behave so in such a mean manner or target people to hurt them or, you know, or do bad things to get a pop. Hurt somebody, traumatize them, and then they go up. I've seen them where they make somebody cry, you know. And then they, ooh, and they get all happy. Yeah, oh gosh, I've seen that a million times. They push you down and they go up like on a seesaw. You're going down on the seesaw, crying and miserable. They won. They got you. They triggered me with that sandwich. They got me. I had to get out of there. Then they threw me under the bus even more, you know, cut me out of the project. And it was just a series of things. There was another one where they had a setup. There's a lot of money that goes by in these things. They meet and they go, well, you know, if you don't give me a good song and dance for the pitch, I'm just going to give it to this guy over here who's a hack, who I know you don't like. And so I'm just going to give him the 30 grand to write this thing. And then I'm never going to produce it. It's just I'm spending 30 grand just to humiliate you. Oh, they spend hundreds of millions of dollars on stuff like this. Yeah, so I knew a producer who spent 30 grand to humiliate me. I didn't care. I said, you know what? I don't care. I'm off in my own world. I'm writing novels. I'm painting. You know, I'm doing just, I don't know. You know, I'm a very other world. They get very mad at me because my head's in the clouds, they say. And I'm you know, I'm not there understanding that, you know, they just humiliated me. It's like, do you get it? No, I don't. Tell me again how you humiliated me. Don't you get it? This has happened over and over and over again. Don't you get it? Yes, but what do you want me to do about it? Well, be my slave. You know, join up. Join what? I can't tell you what. You just have to figure it out. You want to keep getting kicked in the teeth every day? And then eventually, as you get older, of course, you know, all those things, that form of harassment goes away because it just becomes harassment just because, you know, if you could get away with, like, you know, you could harass someone with no karmic repercussions, that's what they think. So it's like when I was younger, that was really my heyday of tagging. What was my role in it? Frank Whalen said I was bait. So what would happen to them? Well, that particular producer, you know, they went out of business and their lives get ruined and their kids are sick or, you know, they have their problems, you know. They seem to be heaped on with problems. Their lives are ruined, is what happens to them. When they go running, screaming away like that, after that, their lives are ruined. The deals don't come in. Phone doesn't ring. You know, that one person just seemed to know what happened to her. Bait. The Lord uses us as bait once in a while. I mean, maybe not all of us. Maybe not me every time, but I mean, he has. And then he, you know, they get tagged and then they get dealt with. And that's why they run away so frightened, because they know that there's a God. They know that God could pull the plug on them and that would be the end of them. Well, what happens is they become discredited with the network they're a part of. They become disconnected. And then, you know, it's taken them years and years to get to that, the position they had. What are they going to do, start over? Yeah, it doesn't go well for them. My advice is don't lead a life where you're mean to people, where you target people, where you follow them, where you try to make them paranoid, where you try to make them doubt their environment, where you rob them of sleep and bully them and, you know, set them up like, I mean, there's a million examples of this where they invite you somewhere, you know, and it seems like it's going to be okay and everything, only to sit there and then toy with you and harass you and say trigger words to traumatize you, thus ruining the dinner they set up for you. You know, they wanted you to be there and they were all buttering you up because it was going to be a setup. I mean, that's happened just about every time out with me. Constantly. And, you know, it's the old thing. It's, you know, so the advice I have is, well, stay away from them then. That's what I should have done. I didn't. I wanted them to like me. I told you what my sin was. I wanted them, so I'd go to the dinner. That was a setup so they could just throw rocks at me. And they did. Humiliated me. And I go home wondering what I did wrong. And I'd just be wondering and wondering and wondering with no answer. Then I'd see them again, like almost apologetic that I, you know, caused them to want to, you know, vomit on me or whatever. And then they would act like they didn't know anything about it. You know, like, oh, we could be friends. Yeah, we're friends. Nothing happened. You're just too sensitive. Oh, and then they want to go again. And then they do the same thing again. I've had a steady diet of that for as long as I can remember. It's always been the same. I like to say this statement. I love you, you hate me. I love you, you hate me. I love you, you hate me back. I love you more and then you hate me even worse. I'm kind to you and you kill me. I love you and you slay me. I love you, you betray me. And in this particular case, it's all organized. That's right. It's all part of gang. And, you know, and if you really want to get into it, the human trafficking is also part of the gang stalking, too. People end up being abducted. And this time, instead of being recruited, they get hauled off against their will. They were lured somewhere where they could be abducted, and they were taken. And that's all part of the same thing, human trafficking. Sex slaves, labor slaves, gang stalking, mobbing, bullying. The carry setup, which is very common. Inviting you somewhere to trigger you from a trauma from the past, and they know what it is, and they know the trigger word. And then you wonder if they're in this, are they in the CIA? Are they in MK Ultra? Or how in the world do they understand that? Supernatural, baby. They just know. They got your whole history. Any one of them could be a puppet and say something. Then you check, did he really say the name of that sandwich? And then when the sandwich came, I saw it was that sandwich. And then he ate it. Is he conscious of the fact that he just triggered me like that? Yes, but he's an actor. He's acting like he isn't conscious of it, but he is. He knows the whole story, even though he wasn't there. See, something is informing him. Wow. So I was just like a train wreck, you know, catching up to the present moment. They're in the present and I'm in the past. They're way out ahead of me. They're waiting for me with that sandwich thing. And then there it is. Well, you know, how do you want to avoid that? You could have pledged your service of slavery to them, and they might have forgiven you. Well, it didn't seem they were asking. No one's going to ask. Well, but then would I do trigger words to somebody else and hurt them? Of course you would. Everything they do, you're going to do. Then I'm not interested because I don't want to hurt people. You know, well, you do it because things will go well if you do. If you don't, things could go bad. So you have to. Oh, yes, you have. But no, they enjoy it. Yes, the other part you didn't understand. They develop a taste for it because when they hurt someone or traumatize someone, which is hurting someone, then they suck up the energy and feed. Oh, okay, so we understand that now. Yes, we do. And if they do it a lot, then they can be, you know, a big star. Probably be best they had a 50-cal machine gun. They could just mow everybody down, all the innocent down, and then they'd really get a pop. Well, if they could get away with it. Do they do each other in? Oh, they do each other in all the time. So I asked that gal, I just said, hey, well, what is this this video about? And the big freak-out meltdown happened. And then, you know, I got the lecture of their things are in a delicate balance, F. And when there's people that upset the apple cart, eventually they're removed from upsetting the apple cart. The nail that sticks up gets hammered down, as you know. Don't be that guy. Well, what do you mean? And then it's like, are you a real person? No, I'm not a real person talking to you. Obviously, I have 1,000 masks. I used to be a person, but then I joined this. And then I lost my personhood. So I'm just a program now coming at you. But I'm not real, no. See, that's what I thought. None of this is really real. It's there to test me to see if I... If you're just trying to break me and have me scream and yell, please help me. The Lord says, welcome. You're doing a great job. You know, this pleases me endlessly that you get dangled in front of them and they take the bait. And then like a train wreck, they die on cue. They get derailed. They run away. All manner of damage has been done. You don't even know it. Thanks, F. Wait a second, I don't want to be bait. I just, look, can I tell you what I'd like? I just want to just have a little bit lighter time of it. More of like an enjoy your beautiful creation, Lord. Well, but people are suffering, son. How much fun can you have knowing that, you know, people are suffering because of this situation? Specifically because of this situation. And they're killing themselves. Specifically because of this situation. How much fun can you really have? Wow. This was a heavy podcast, man. Sheesh. I should have put the energy working on a song. I've got some melodies now that are awesome, but I don't know when I'm going to get a break from this. I'm going to head back to bed now. Well, I feel I can sleep now. I just feel like I'm poured out wine now. The wineskin is emptied. I just, yeah. You know, I've cursed my mother's womb many times. I've cursed my birth many times, and recently even many times. I hate it. I hate this world. How cruel and awful it is, you know. When I say the world, I mean the world of man. The world of I don't hate humanity at all, you know. It's this system, this world system, this world that I find intolerable because of its deceptiveness and a downright meanness to innocent people that meant no harm. Again, we're back on that theme again, but I mean, that's just God. All you want me to tell him about what's going to happen? Terror every, yeah. Well, they called the terror off. I don't care what Belgium does. It's the powers that be that run the terror, you know, not terrorists somewhere in a little ghetto somewhere. That's ridiculous. Everybody knows everything about everybody, so it's, you know, that's kind of ridiculous in this day and age. But they think you'll believe it, so they lay that on you. They had to call off. They got the wrong reaction. People were like cheering on Putin and Trump and stuff like that, and they weren't getting the reaction that they wanted, which was, you know, government, please protect us. You know, more government, more protection. So they have to retool, and then they're going to go again. But yeah, the kings of terror. This is what I envisioned back in 2004. It took a long time. It took 11 years for it to kind of come to pass. But, you know, the kings of terror are back, you know, are rolling. And I used to write about the kings of terror, but they never really developed back then when I was writing about it. But they are certainly, you know, in full force now. I just think there's a pause here because, and like I say, it's spotty. You know, it's over here, it's over there. It's kind of like the school, you know, the school shooting hoaxes. And now, I think from now on, you're all, on all these hoaxes, they're going to have dead bodies because that seems to be the clincher in terms of people believing it. They can't go with no dead bodies because they've tried that with a couple of these shootings where nobody dies, and then, you know, there's too many questions, and the internet goes, the internet went nuts on Paris. The next day was false flag city, baby, everywhere you look. And now we got firecrackers, we got all kinds of fake stuff going on, guys with fake guns. Guy takes a gun, he aims at a woman's head like he's gonna shoot her. He then wanders off. He obviously had no intention of firing the gun. His gun did not jam. He was just like an actor playing pretend, you know. So there are actors, you know, who are in and amongst murderers in the PSYOP. And so these actors are, they're the same that are the crisis actors. These are scumbags and traitors to humanity. But, you know, if you get close to popping that one, they'll just kill you. Anyone that really knows about it, like where these people live, they'll just kill you. If they get close, like one of them wants to be a whistleblower, they'll kill him or her. You're dealing with the big leagues now. Anyone knows anything, they get killed. I mean, it's serious, but they have to figure out how they can have a terror attack that people will believe, because nobody believed the Paris one. And the news media keeps going, now, you know, this Paris, we got to make sure it doesn't happen again. They're all reacting to it. We live in a two-tiered reality, obviously. But I mean, you know, it was a joke, the terror. I know people are dead, but the whole thing was a joke. And if that band was in on it, part of the PSYOP, then shame on them. And also, my note for the band members is this. If you were in on that, they're going to kill you, all of you. Hope you understand that. It's going to be like, make it look like all natural kind of things, car accidents, this, that. But they're going to kill you if you know anything. And I think I have a feeling they do. Oh, God. Because they were spared, obviously. I have a feeling they know exactly what's going on. You better run. You better hide. Hey, you hey, band. What is your stupid name? Eagles. I hate the Eagles. Eagles of death metal. And you were singing about Satan. And you're singing about glorifying the devil while the shooting's going on. Whether you know or not, you're part of it. I think you better turn around 180 degrees and go to the Lord, because that's the only way you're going to get your ass out of this thing. And if you can't manage that, good luck. But they tend to kill people that know something. That's all. All them terrorists wound up dead. Yeah, anyone that knows anything will wind up dead. Yep. To make sure that Paris attack is real, damn it. We got dead bodies, we got blood. Yep. I have a feeling that band knows something, and I hope they don't, but there's plenty of crisis actors involved in the Paris thing. And they're finding them. They found one, a Ginny something or other. And, you know, there's this one guy that's kind of exposing it, and he's like, he can barely do it because, you know, these are such scumbags of our society, you know. What kind of person would take part in something like that as an actor? I mean, you know, as a traitor to humanity, basically. Someone that would condone psychopathic, you know, people who plot this stuff and carry it out. So they're just damn serious about going for their new world order. I mean, you know, this is all part of it, all these terror attacks. You know, the idea, again, going back to Albert Pike, is to horrify you so you scream for world government, then bring in a Luciferian one world government and society with the requirement of a Luciferian initiation. Yes, everyone must break on through the other side overtly and publicly, and then Lucifer gets to be, hopefully, possess a human and reign upon the earth with all the children just enjoying their pedophilia that's being done to them in the name of Satan. Oh, that's the other thing I forgot to mention. The pedophilia angle. Well, there was some obscure movie that Marilyn Manson was in where he was like this pedophile, and it looked like he really enjoyed it. Yeah, it was like it was just part of it. They tried to make it look acceptable. And I always thought that he was really a scumbag for taking part in that. Yeah, don't cross my path, Brian. Good idea. Yeah, that was really pretty low. It involved a truck stop, and I don't know, it's just a dark little movie. Yeah, I know who directed it. I believe it was Dario Argento, the horror director, his daughter, I think. Or no, she was an actress in it. She was an actress in it. So did she direct it? Somebody directed it. I think she directed it too. Anyway, it's going to catch up with you people. The Lord is going to Terror Big, coming to a theater drive-in near you. When the nukes go off, or any kind of dirty bomb, or any kind of anything like that, even a rumor of one, there will be, you know, martial law everywhere. So enjoy these nice days you've got, children. It's going to get worse. There will be a recompense for the evil. All of these terror attacks, 9/11, which was another one, another psyop, all this stuff that's been done will be recompensed by the Lord. All the hurting, all people that have just had it, all the people who've become shut-ins and traumatized through no fault of their own, the Lord will avenge you. I hope you understand that. But why don't you start by at least going to the Lord? You don't want it. I don't want vengeance either. I don't need it. But when he does avenge, we are supposed to be grateful that that this kind of thing won't happen to somebody else, you see. That he's eliminating the very system that has given rise to this bullying and this stalking and this covert war that's been going on, that's been breaking people and shutting them in and, you know, making them, you know, wish they were never born and, you know, just good people that meant no one any harm, just walking into a gauntlet like that. I mean, just imagine the trauma and pain and horror of some unsuspecting person not knowing what the hell they did to, you know, trying to figure out what kind of world they just stepped into. All I could say is welcome to the NFL. You wouldn't even be on the earth here unless you were very gifted and very powerful. You know, you come in with amnesia, stripped of power. You got to find your way back home. Hint, let me give you a little hint. Home is not where the entertainers are. Home is not where the world is. Home is not where the politicians are. Home is not where the you know, the world system is. Home is here, in a sense, but through a spiritual portal, through another realm. Somehow we got separated from, you know, who we really are. And this is all about getting back to who we know we are. And Jesus Christ is the, you know, the way back. The Word of God, the Bible, is going to be that thing that keeps informing. You're going to see this go on. You know, this whole thing went on with the prophets of old, you see. And they killed them. It went on with Jesus and the followers of Jesus. And it's going on today, the same as it was then. You see what I mean? You might as well know why you're being persecuted. It's really persecution you're suffering, not so much gang stalk. It's persecution. And it can come in any form. But basically, it's like, you know, the people that have given up are used as sock puppets. And the thing that's in them are these hungry jackals that hate humans. And you're a human. You know, you're still intact. You still have your soul. So therefore, you're the enemy. And they're coming at you with vengeance because you threaten. You represent something that threatens their very existence, that they are even dependent on for their existence, which makes it even, you know, them doubly screwed. And they know they're screwed. They still want to do the scorched earth, take as many humans down with them as they can. It's an ancient war, my friends, an ancient war. We get caught up in it and think it's about us. It's not about us. The things I mentioned that occurred, you know, I didn't mention, you know, the poisonings and the sabotaging of the vehicles and the, you know, from motorcycle, truck, lighting a car on fire. While I was in it, you know, trying to trap me in it, all kinds of stuff. Oh, it was just an accident. I see. All kinds of stuff like that, just thing after thing. Had a Volkswagen van and the guy kept sabotaging it. I said, will you please stop sabotaging? You know, I didn't go to him like that, but I just said, you know what? You know, he goes, well, that thing could have blown up. You could have died. And I'm like, well, then fix it. And eventually, what I did to him, it was an old Volkswagen van. What I did to the mechanic, I drove it down there one day. I said, here, it's my gift to you. You can have it. Since you refused to fix it. And he's the only one that worked on that air-cooled engine here in town. So I just gave it to him. I think it kind of blew his mind. I said, you know, that's it. I've been down here, and you've screwed up my engine enough. I've been on the verge of blowing a thing up and getting in an accident and everything else since I've been here. So guess what? It's yours now. So that kind of thing, you know, restaurants, you know, the pattern of behavior, you know, if you're used to going someplace over and over again, you know, you got to change your pattern. Because they be waiting for you. Yeah. Well, I guess I'm somewhat of a recluse and a shut-in myself, you know, in the sense that a lot of time I just don't want to deal with them, you know. I just don't want to deal with this battle. So I just avoid it. You know what I mean? Life is too short. When I see a rose blooming, I want to be able to go out and smell that rose and, you know, have hope in life. And I look at the sun and the firmament. It's beautiful tonight with the big moon out there. And the stars are kind of faded because of that. And you can sort of see the land and the terrain. And Thanksgiving's coming up, and I want to think good about that. You know, I mean, in a sense, I guess I don't come from America. I'm not really an American. I've kind of come to this place. What do I think about the flat earth, since I alluded to it earlier? Well, I've been kind of like busy, you know, dealing with this spiritual warfare. Yeah, I haven't had a lot of time to. I look up at the firmament every night. I take Dasha out every night, and I because I want to go out there. And now she does her business, and you know, we kind of have a routine. So I go out there, I look at the firmament, and I go, "Someday, Lord, you're going to show me what do I need to know about this firmament, Lord." And honestly, what comes back is nothing. Is the earth flat or round, Lord? Nothing. Is are we in a dome? Is Sheol beneath us, hell, and then heaven is above us? You know, yes. Is it true I come from up there and not down here? Yes, you come from up there. Is it true that where I came from is no planet or locus on some kind of object? Correct. So I know a bit, you know, but as far as whether the earth is, you know, I don't get a pat answer whether it's round or flat or whatever. I wouldn't be surprised if it turns out to be a dome of some kind, you know, like described in the Bible. And I'm, you know, if it's a random universe of billions and trillions and billions of little balls spinning around in space, fine. I don't care, really. I mean, it's just not really a big subject. Do I question NASA? You bet. I don't trust them as far as I can throw them. Of course not. I don't trust anyone, really. I mean, you know, the media, the textbooks I had in school. I mean, they all seem to be filled with lies. So could they lie about all this and the universe and everything else? Of course they could. Can they lie about going to the moon? Of course they can. Lie, 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 lie. Everything's a lie here. My only hope, my friends, is the Lord God and the fact that he's a light, but I'm a light too. You know, we are salt and light, those of us who truly follow the Lord Jesus. And I guess I follow him. I may not be the best person, but I follow him because I have nowhere else to go. So the Lord has kept it that way. I asked to keep me broken so that keeping me broken means there is no place else to go. There's no place for me to wander off to. Certainly the people in the world system are a bore because they believe that the castles they made on the sand are going to stay forever. How can I be friends with that? How can I relate to that even? I can't. You know, I saw through it when I was, 6 years old. And it seems that since then, it's been this kind of back and forth battle since then. It's never let up. Before, when I thought it was fairy tales and rainbows and lollipops, nobody ever bothered me. Things seemed fine. Or maybe that was untrue too. But it was like when they put me back with that, where they said, all these thoughts are delusion. They convinced me that it was lollipops and rainbows again. And then I had all these actors as friends who were just, you know, acting as friends. You know, they were paid. Well, that was certainly bizarre. But during that time, I had no harassment. I was just floating. I was like in a bubble, floating along, being managed by people who would show up on the movie set every day. And it was like Truman. It was the Truman Show exactly. So I did that, and then that blew apart. You know, it all gets blown apart. Every plan they've ever had fails. That's the other thing. Everything they ever do fails in the end. And at the end of the day, they may be accomplished and they may give each other awards for the demonic powers that they received in the form of music or acting or entertainment of some sort. But it's, you know, then they can pretend they actually came up with it on their own and how gifted and unique they are. And they can just lavish each other with awards all they want till the cows come home. It's still not true. You know, it's an illusion, this world. I mean, the world is an illusion. My world, where I am, in my realm, it's not an illusion at all. It's real. But the world is an illusion based on a lie. And, you know, that's why you can't really believe, you know, a lot of things in education, news, media, politicians, entertainers, you know, the mavens of our society, and what they tell you is truth usually isn't. So eventually a wise soul will wise up and go, you know what? Every dang thing they've been telling me is a lie. Ding. Yes, you get the prize. Give that man a hula hoop. You won. It's all basically a lie. So it is a matrix or a delusion, but God's realm in the same space is equally real and no hologram at all, meaning, you know, maybe it's holographic, but it's no illusion. It's no lie. It's real. God's realm is real. And it's right here in the same space. So my world right here is real. Their world right here isn't. And I'm glad to make that distinction. I am to believe 100% in my realm and to follow, you know, the rules accordingly, to be obedient to the Lord, to serve the Lord, to keep the Lord involved is the main thing he's talking about there. Stay in the Word of God. Keep reading the scriptures, you know. Keep inspired, you know. You know, keep trying to work it out on the earth, you know, whether it's, you know, knowing that, you know, there's a lot of deception out there, but knowing there's other kindred spirits and there's some nice people online. I see good people on video. I see, you know, good people trying to run for office, and, you know, the wheat and the tares are growing together. But fundamentally, from the Lord's point of view, the world is very real. It's not a flight simulator, as I called it before. It's the real thing. But it is created and managed. Yeah, you could call it a flight simulator, but in a sense, but there's nothing fake about it, really, you know, from the Lord's point of view. From the world's point of view, yes, flight simulator, fake. From the Lord's point of view, no, feet on the ground, real. Both occupying the same space. Very paradoxical. Very hard to describe. But you can't say it's all fake and you can't say it's all real, can you? Well, I hope this helped. I'm sorry if you got angry at me for sounding like I was putting you down. I'm not putting you down. I'm trying to cut through the BS that's out there. And it's really hard to do because there's so many people wanting a terrestrial solution to an extraterrestrial, to a non-terrestrial problem. And it's just apples and oranges. It's just there's never gonna be a solution to your gang stalking, let's say, to being a TI in terrestrial terms. You'll never really escape it. You know, it's like I've known people that first they had implants and then they went back and there were no implants to be removed. You know, there's that sort of thing. That happens. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Then there isn't. And once you start getting on to that as the nature of reality, it's so scary that you have to go to the Lord. Lord, please take me. Please take me to bed now and let me sleep without all these horrible thoughts. Do I want to see terror? No. But, you know, and then they're having to retool right now. Because the public reaction is, you know, at least in this country, it's more guns, hatred of Obama, who's screwed you but good. I mean, he is the biggest traitor to America that I don't know if I can remember one in history that is as much a traitor. But the problem is half the people here are traitors along with him. They hate this country, and they want to transform it into... They don't want a country. They just want the borders open and the rule of law thrown out the window. And anyone that they don't like who says the wrong thing, they want them jailed. I mean, this is beyond banana dictatorship, banana republic. But he's made a mockery out of the military, mockery out of everything. One thing is for certain, you know, the problem with this country, the way I see it, is this country manufactures enemies and boogeymen to go after, and then we spend a lot of blood and treasure going after things that they themselves created. And that's eventually going to come bite you in the ass. I mean, that's especially when there's good people here who don't know anything about all this, who believe the news, what they see on TV, and just couldn't imagine a world that where to be like something I just described. But you show me that, and I'll show you the same people that are taking part, compartmentalizing in a compartmental way in all this stalking and hurting of other people, and they don't think they're hurting anyone. Oh, yeah. Don't forget that part of it, too. When you really see it for what it is, you don't hold humanity responsible. You look at humanity and go, gosh, I'm really sorry. I'm so sorry for you, for the direction you've chosen to go, because it's going to be, it's you've gone and you're going to your own destruction, even though it looks like you're riding high now. It won't be long before you curse your mother's womb, too. You know, it's, I guess on this earth there's a pay now and go free later, or you could pay later and go free now. Payment's a bitch. Well, for me, Jesus paid for me in blood, and that set me free. So I don't relate to that game. No, I don't relate to that game. I mean, people will persecute you for that, but I mean, you know, the Lord also won't give you more than you can handle. I mean, he'll turn bad things into good. You know, you just have to hang with him. But yeah, this is a conundrum here. This is a, you know, I'm not sure this is a place you go to enjoy anything. You know, I mean, when your eyes are fully open, you're not bummed out. Like, I'm not bummed out at all. And I chirp like the birds, and I create music, which is like birds chirping, right? So I do that. That shows I'm happy. I'm generally happy as a person. But my eyes are open, and I see. So because my eyes are open, you're not having an ongoing celebration, and then you get bummed out when the bad times come. You kind of roll with it. No, you see that it's all the fundamental situation is something humanity can't win. And so that's why Jesus was a man of sorrow. And I understand that's a sorrowful thing to look at humanity. It's not so much like you're angry. It's more, you know, humanity is so ignorant in its choices. And just look at the whole, you know, thing with the race relations and what these people say on television. It shows they're so ignorant. They want to change the language at universities, and if people get fired because they had, you know, they're going to take every icon that had something to do with slavery and take them off the dollar bill or whatever. You know, it's just on and on. There's no end to it. And you feel so sorry, but there's nothing that you or I can do about it. I'm not here to pray for the world. I'm here to pray for those that the Lord has given to Jesus. You know, and but I don't pray for the world. I'm not praying for, otherwise I'd be praying for gang stalkers to be more successful, right? No, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to pray that the ignorant get their reward with more ignorance. No, I'm not going to do that. I think the way that we get through this thing is, you know, we've got to be blameless. You know, like I say, I oftentimes overpay my taxes. You know, I try to do everything above board, you know, everything. I'm a law-abiding citizen. I follow the laws. I pay my taxes. I follow the rules. You know, I worship the Lord. I love the Lord. I don't go where the people are going to be harming me, you know. So, I mean, I've had to stay away, you know, a lot from, you know, where they're not friendlies. You know, I'm not going to go where they're going to harass me, obviously, for just being a normal person. And that's, folks, hate to say it like that, but you're being harassed or stalked or whatever you want to call it for being a normal person, for being an intact person, for not being broken. Pray the Lord breaks you his way, and then just stay broken and stay with him. You know, we're walking this thing out. With the Lord, though, I have confidence, you know. I know that bullies go down. I know that the bad guys eventually lose. I know that in this world, God is moving right now, prophetically, in a way that he has not been for thousands of years. So we'll see what that brings. And with that, I bid you shalom. We'll see you next time.